good evening, good afternoon, good morning, whatever time of the day you are listening me to. I am very glad we are doing this class right now. The last time that we were learning EVS in the classroom, we reached up to biological prospecting. What is biological prospecting? For all those, let's do a nice recap. It's when you are trying to identify certain compounds in certain species of plants and animals which can be used for a variety of uses even in the future. For example, the pharmaceutical industry, they use certain compounds of the plants and they use it for medicinal purposes. There are various other crops which are saved. There are various gene banks which are made in which various crops and seeds are saved. So in case there is a flood and an entire agricultural field gets washed out, you certainly have preserved and saved certain seeds which can be used to re-establish the kind of farming that people are dependent on. There are people who do a lot of farming. There are people who do a lot of fishing. And imagine if one of those drought days and you do not get enough of water or rainfall, what happens to all those crops under the sun? They die. They dry up. So in such cases, there is always a gene bank which is preserved so that if there can be some testing, and there are a lot of various kinds of biotechnologists which do work and researches on such things. So in case you want to develop a crop which can stay under harsh conditions, under a lot of sunlight, but with just a little bit of enough of water, you can develop that through all these various researches that are done. So biological prospecting actually helps in keeping what is already there in the biodiversity, in the biotic world, and yet developing it further for the future generations, which can be helpful for them during various trying times, you know, difficult days. So imagine that if I didn't know how to do video recording, probably I would not have been able to record a video and send it to you right now. So I learned about it in the past so that it can be helpful in the future. Similarly, if there are certain genes that are preserved, so for example, Gir Gai, right? The Gir cows, which are famous for various reasons, for its milk, for its A2 milk, which is very famous these days. It's expensive. There are various properties of the cows that are used once the cow dies, yes, including the leather, including the various so there are various uses of the byproducts of the cow apart from just milk, and this is used in medicine. This is also used in trying to develop a better a culture of Gir cows, which is going to be useful for the future generations. So this is what is biological prospecting. Moving on, we are talking about the social values of biodiversity. Now, we talked about this in class as well, that Tulsi is the only plant that also gives out oxygen in the night, and that is the reason why every household in India has a Tulsi plant, often known as basil. It is a little different in terms of its genetic value. So when basil or Tulsi plant is kept in the home, it is not just for oxygen but also for the medicinal reasons, right? Often when we cough or we have a bad cold, our mother usually gives us Tulsi, and along with some gourd, or she gives us Tulsi in milk. This is the medicinal value of Tulsi. Apart from that, the social value of biodiversity in the form of animals. There are a lot of people who worship cows. There are a lot of people who worship say even mouse, turtles. There can be various people who would like to worship various different, depending on their religion, they would like to worship various different animals and birds even, right? So there are various birds which are also worshipped, and this is why we have the snake, the people, the cow, the banyan tree, the Tulsi plant. These are various, they have a lot of social value in the human world. You might want to look about the social values of the crops all around the world. There's another point which is known as the ethical and the moral values. When we are talking about ethics, we mean something that we truly believe in, whether it is there in a particular scripture or not, or whether it is there in a particular rule book or not. For example, cutting trees in my society, ethically it is wrong, right? Ethically it would be right if there is a sapling being planted for every girl child that is born. Ethically it would be wrong to burn branches and trees in public, because that would just give rise to a lot of pollution. So we do not have the right to destroy a lot of forms. For example, the book talks about this particular tribe called the Bishnoi tribe, which was there, which lives in the Terai region somewhere, I guess around Rajasthan and all. So they talk about how the Bishnois used to worship a particular plant. So like you already know, in the semi-arid and then arid regions, there are very thorny trees. There are very few bushes and trees which provide shelter, and it becomes a habitat for a lot of natural living organisms, for a lot of small reptiles. It is also housed for a lot of insects. So in the very earlier times, when there were kings and kingdoms, so the king used to chop down all those trees, and for the personal reasons like furniture or fuel, or to keep themselves warm during the winter times, as a firewood. So during that time, the Bishnoi tribe, they used to protect the trees. They used to wrap their hands around the trees and they used to protect them. They used to tell that, you know, until you don't kill us, you cannot kill this particular plant. You know, it is a shelter. It is, the leaves provide fodder, food for a lot of goats and such other as sheep and animals. It is also a place where a lot of travelers settle and sleep during the traveling time, because in the earlier days there were no trains and planes. You know, people used to walk and travel from one end to the other end of the village. So the Bishnoi tribe, they basically believe that you cannot chop down these trees. If you want to, you have to, you know, kill us first. So this is the ethical value. This is how they saved a lot of species of plants in that particular area. So they are not just praised for what they did, the bravery of the Bishnoi tribe, but also such trees are worshipped. Now, when you are worshipping a banyan tree, when you are worshipping a peepal tree, when you are worshipping various animals, you should look at the history. You should ask your parents why such things are done. It is not, it definitely has a value. It is not for no reason at all. Your grandparents might know it, or you can just Google through it these days. Yes, so they are preserved for special ethical reasons as well. We do protect a lot of neem trees, and the reason is during the mosquito time, during the rainy season, it is these neem leaves that save us. You know, people put neem leaves in water and bathe with it. People put neem leaves and try to burn it in the house and in the veranda, so that there are no insects, bugs or mosquitoes in the house that trouble us. And there are various other reasons. So these are known as moral and ethical values of people. That is how it is used. Aesthetic value, another point. The aesthetic means the beauty of the thing. We talked about it in class in a bit, little bit. We talked about how there are various sanctuaries and zoos and various wildlife parks and gardens which are developed for its ethical value, for its aesthetic value. We also talk about how it becomes a part of tourist attraction. So when you have a beautiful garden, say for example there are various gardens in Gandhinagar area. So when you go and sit in that area, it brings you peace of mind, the greenery, it gives you good time. You can walk around, it becomes a dada-dadi park and a nana-nani park in various areas. If you come to Ahmedabad, there are a lot of Amul Oda gardens. So that is actually a place where kids can play in the evening, there is no pollution, you can do yoga, the elderly people can walk around the park. There are various other such aesthetic values of gardens and other grasslands that are around the city, right? Apart from that, not just grass, not just forest, there are various animals and birds which also become part of the aesthetic value. For example, a mouse has an aesthetic value. We try and if we are going to any temples, we see that there's a small mouse near Lord Ganesha. Lord Ganesha again has an elephant head, so again that is an aesthetic value. It has a moral story behind it, and it is believed to be there as part of our mythological stories and values and culture and just about everything else. And there are certain culture in which even fishes are they provide to be an aesthetic value. So when you go to various temples, when you go to various historical monuments, and if you see those small little carvings of those certain animals, birds and reptiles, that means that there was an aesthetic value of these animals and living beings even during that time. There is also a very nice example of how lion is one of those wild species which has an aesthetic value in Hinduism. In Buddhism, there is an elephant and other such deities which have either connections with a whale or a snake or a peacock, and they go to generations and generations, and they have a lot of value in the human life. Moving on, there's something called an option value. That means preservation of biodiversity includes a lot of traditionally used strains already in existence in crops and domestic animals. This is linked with the biological prospecting that we are talking about. This is also linked with the gene bank that we were talking about, that in future when you need options, like in Indonesia and in India, there were a variety of rice, chokha, right, that was developed during the centuries and centuries of human cycle. So because there are certain rice crop which are not very famous, there are certain rice crop which do not yield a lot of money when they are sold in the market. There are a lot of rice crop which do not yield too much in quantity, but you are giving in so much of hard work in trying to harvest them by the farmers, right? So that is the reason there were a lot of such variety of rice which got extinct. So they stopped making or stopped harvesting. They stopped trying to build that particular paddy field where a different variety of rice was grown. But their seeds are preserved, and for any future reasons when the need arises, these gene banks which have certain crops and seeds which can be used for further cultivation, they can always be available. There are various gene banks for agriculture, horticulture, various forest museums which try and preserve such things, such seeds and roots, for example. We move down to the next point, which is called biodiversity at global, national and local areas. It talks about 1.8 million known species that have been documented by scientists throughout the world, right? So for example, what is happening in the world right now? Corona, it never appeared in the history earlier. But once upon a time, there was a swine flu. Now, if there is swine flu, we definitely know what's causing it. We can stop it and we will try and prevent it from spreading across. So similarly, now that coronavirus is here, you try and develop, various biotechnologists try and develop what is this virus about, how does it enter the human body, what is the exact medicine for it, how can it be stopped from spreading to various humans, why is it that this particular virus spreads to the humans and not to the animals, right? Because it has come from the animals and the birds. So there are various reasons for that. There are various studies that are happening, and at a global, national or at a local level, when there is a pandemic or an epidemic, this is how such biodiversity genes and species, that is how it helps us. When you have a lot of studies done about it, when you have a lot of scientists working on it, like for example in America you see a lot of ravens, but in India you see crows. So they are similar, Yeah, they come from the same genetics. They are different. No, they come from the same species, but they have different genes. They have different beaks. They have different food habits, and that all depends on the cross-cultural nations that are developing. That all depends on the different geographical locations, and that is why you do not see a raven in India, right? So there can be a raven and a crow, and there can be something else that looks similar. So combining all of this, there are about 1.8 million species that are documented and recorded. There are various scientists who are also researching about the new kind of species that are developing on earth, under the water, in various different situations. If you remember, we talked about the lizard. Yes, so there is one species of lizard, but there are different genetic values, and that is how there are different kinds of lizards that are developing around the world. There are different kind of cockroaches that are developing around the world. So if you look at them, you will say, okay, this is a lizard. Okay, this is a kind of a goat, or this is a kind of a deer. But there are various kind of deers available or can be seen only in India. Forget about the rest of the world, right? So out of that 1.8 million, let's talk about mainly India. There are various sanctuaries, and there are various wildlife reserved areas. There are a lot of places, like you have something called the Manas Sanctuary, which is there on the border of Bhutan and India. There is Kaziranga in Assam. There is Bharatpur, which is in UP. There is something called the Nanda Devi in Himalayas, which is very famous for its deer. There is a particular deer that is found only in the Himalayas, in the entire of India. And they are, of course, in the preserved wild sanctuaries. And there's something called the Gir National Forest Museum and the Gir Sanctuary, which is there in Gujarat. There are various World Heritage Conventions and international agreements which are talking about such species which are about to be extinct, or which are prevailing, or which needs help for multiplying in its number. And there are various international agreements being signed between a lot of countries, a lot of states also, to develop such species for economic reasons, as well as trying to develop them for building a natural habitat for them. So for example, you do not see zebras in India, but there is a very beautiful sanctuary called the Periyar Wildlife Sanctuary in Kerala, which has a zebra. And basically the zebra is brought into India through all these national and international agreements, right? So then we might be sending away a few of our animals there, or they might be sending a few of the animals here, or birds. There are various birds which also migrate. So there are certain pelicans and certain other birds which stay in Siberia in Russia, and they migrate during the winter season here. So the winters there are very harsh, and it is difficult to live there. The lakes are basically frozen, and the birds which live on various crops, or the birds which live on the fishes that is available in the pond, the food is not available to them. So they travel all the way to India. Imagine, kilometers and kilometers they travel to India, they migrate, and they stay here throughout the winter season. So yes, there are various conventions which study that. There's always something mentioned here that India has signed the convention in the trade of endangered species, which means that to reduce the utilization of certain species, certain animals and birds for economic reasons. So for example, if you know, we do have a limited number of tigers in India. But a few years back, there was a Save the Tiger foundation that was created, and there were people who were protesting against the use of tigers for tourists' purposes, the use of tigers for poaching. They were strictly against the killing of tigers for medicinal reasons. So the bones of these tigers, there are bones which are used for medicines, and the tooth and the nail, there is a lot of illegal activity that goes on for buying and selling of such things. There is a lot of medicinal value for the fur and the bone, and the meat is being sold in the market for at an exorbitant amount. So this is what India is doing at the moment. They are trying to sign various agreements with sanctuaries and other wildlife forests, and they are trying to take an action against all those people who are involved in such illegal activities. And there can be fine or you can be jailed for a number of years if you are found using or doing any economic trade of the list of species that is under the endangered species list. Yes, so you cannot do any trading. Moving on, India as a mega diversity nation, they are talking about how the land or how all the continents was once a huge place of land, and due to the tectonic movements there were different continents that were built. And they say that it is very much possible that Africa and India were one, because there is a lot of similarities in the species that is found in Africa and India. And we are rich in terms of biodiversity. India is one of the most beautiful nations where you see a lot of biodiversity and a lot of national parks, a lot of greenery, a lot of different kind of species. And Andaman Nicobar Islands is one of the hot spots, and it is being preserved in a very beautiful way. There are certain species which cannot be found anywhere around the world but in Andaman Nicobar Islands. So they're talking about India in being the top 10 or 15 countries for its great variety of plants and animals, out of which there are 1200 species of birds. This is beautiful. I can name only about 20 to 25 of them which I know or which I see around me, but there are 1200 species of birds in India only, right? And they're talking about 45,000 number of plant species that is available in India. Some of them are preserved in greenhouse forests, greenhouse places, and some of them are preserved in forests and restricted areas in India. They're talking about 50,000 known species of insects. Okay, we'll not talk about that. It's a little gross to talk about cockroaches and tiny bugs and insects, right? This also includes all your ants and all the other various insects which are found only on plants, not in the house or not in the forest, only on plants, right? And there are certain insects which are only found around the places in say the water or the water bodies in India. There are about 13,000 types of butterflies that are found in India, and they are also talking about various 1022 types of grasslands and orchids that are found in India. It is a very nice, beautiful piece of how many number of which species. They're talking about 153 species of lizards that are found only in India, and you can read about it. It's there on page number 93 and 94 in the biodiversity chapter. It talks about how all these it talks about how all these varieties of cereals, vegetables and other gene banks which have been preserving all these pulses and cereals, and there are 27 types of cattle that is available in India. There are 22 types of only goats that are available in India. And all of these which are there, which makes India a very rich nation in terms of biodiversity, how most of it is preserved. They are talking about hotspots in India. So for example, whichever part has a national sanctuary is definitely going to be a hotspot, and that is the reason why it has been turned into a national sanctuary. They're talking about Andaman Nicobar Islands being at the topmost level. It is where it's lush green, there's a lot of water available in the around, and that is the reason why and there isn't much of pollution, population as well, which can cause endangerment to such species. We are also talking about the threats to the biodiversity in India. We're talking about the loss of habitat for certain animals and birds. We are talking about poaching. We are talking about human wildlife conflicts. So for example, there are a lot of places, there are a lot of grasslands which are used for used as habitat for say small little animals. It is used by insects and other birds, but because there is a need for developing certain agricultural land, or there is a need for certain places that can be cleared for making say buildings or other colonies for humans to dwell on, and that is the reason why a lot of these places are cut, shredded, the grasses are removed, it is made barren, and then it is sold away to humans for various construction reasons. They are talking about how certain wetlands which were used for by crabs and other small little aqua animals, now they have been converted into agricultural land, and there are various pesticides which are first sprayed into that wetland so that those crabs and other crustaceans can die, and then it is cultivated or developed into an agricultural land. So this is known as human animal or the human wildlife conflict. Yes, and like it's mentioned, there are about 1.8 million million species of plants and animals that is known to the world. Now imagine if we try and decrease the habitat which is essential for the breeding of such marine fish or animals or such other land animals, such other forest essentials, then the productive value that we are getting from it, it will not be available for us. If we try and if we do a lot of poaching activities, that is we try and do a lot of hunting activities, we do overfishing, we try and take away the land which was used as habitat, we try and take it away and we have our own cultivation, or we have our own various constructions that are happening on those places, it is going to be a loss not only to humans, it is going to be lost to wildlife, and there might be so many tiny species, like out of those 50,000 there might be many who are living in these wetlands, and they can eventually die and be extinct if you try and take up all the land from them and all the water as well. Okay, moving on, they are talking about how there are certain islands which were used for commercial purpose, and that made they're giving a very nice example. In Madagascar there was a very beautiful bird called dodo which became extinct only because there were a lot of the space on the island was used by humans for various cultivation and other construction reasons, and because of that particular species have been extinct. Yes, so probably our forefathers saw them and we didn't. And we are also talking about various other bio-rich areas such as the tropical forest, the wetlands and the coral reefs that needs to be preserved. Otherwise, if we lose them, we might not have certain coral reefs by the year 2050, which is not going to be good for the biodiversity of the marine life, because there are various marine fishes which are dependent on the coral reefs to live. There are various other microorganisms which act as decomposers in the marine life, which are also dependent on coral reef. Some of them also live in those corals, so we need to preserve them. Okay, we are also talking about this particular Project Tiger. It is a case study. It talks about how there were only 9 tiger reserves which the Project Tiger talks about how there were 9 tiger reserves in the year 1972, and now there are about 1500 tigers there are about 1500 tigers in 23 tiger reserves which were developed. So we'll be talking about more on the Project Tiger thing in the next chapter when we are talking about in situ and ex situ. Let's move on to this particular topic called overexploitation. What is overexploitation? It is when there are a lot of tourists who visit such sanctuaries and such natural reserves, and they try and create a big thing out of it. So all those people who are visiting Gir National Sanctuary in Gujarat, they are not just creating pollution with all those jeeps that move around in the national park. They are also trying to breach in the privacy of those animals, right? So it is not helping them when during the breeding season. It is not helpful for them when they are resting during a particular time of the day. It is also not good when you are trying to pave paths and make it into a commercial place, like selling of certain forest products outside a national sanctuary. There are various plants and trees that they are talking about, the trees like the teak or the sal or the mango trees, the wood of these trees are used for various other reasons, but they are also used as a habitat for various birds and various species which are living in those forests as well. So they are talking about an alternate source of fodder which is not being regenerated, but the natural source of fodder which is there in the forest is getting it is getting decreased day by day because of the over exploitation of that particular place. So there are natural resources that are available, but again a lot of tourists come around, they try and trample on those grasses and fodder that is available. They trample on a lot of insects by mistake, or they are not aware of it. That is what I mean. Yes, and they're also talking about various exotic species which are available. So for example, there are various exotic weeds that are available in India, and they try and preserve them for medicinal reasons. They are also talking about a particular tree which is known as rab, which is also only found in the Himalayan regions, and we need to preserve them because they are exotic species. And they are also talking about certain marine turtles which are dying because they are also exotic in nature. They get caught in fishing nets, and that is the reason why such marine species and animals and other marine life, they are being massacred a lot because of fishing reasons. So there are various endangered species such as the rare whale shark, and it is often found on the coast of Gujarat and Orissa. But because of these fishing nets, or because of various other activities that are happening, like oil refineries and other things which are there on the coast.